you. I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation to talk here and for the hospitality. So I'll be talking about Moebius maps. So let me start with the Moebius group in n dimensions. So this is a group which acts on Rn union point at infinity, and it can be defined as the group generated by reflections in hyperplanes and inversions in spheres. And it can be characterized as the group of homeomorphisms of Rn union infinity which preserve cross ratios of quadruples of distinct points. So where the cross ratio is a positive real number here, which is defined by a ratio of products of distances. So if you have 4 points, xi, eta, xi prime, eta prime, then it's going to be the product of these two distances divided by the product of those two distances. And Rn union infinity, you can map by stereographic projection to the sphere Sn. So if you conjugate the Moebius group, you get the Moebius group acting on the sphere Sn. And stereographic projection also preserves cross ratios. So the Moebius group of Sn is again characterized as the group of homeomorphisms of Sn preserving cross ratios. So the cross ratio is given by the same formula for points on Sn. Now the Moebius group comes up when you look at the conformal models of hyperbolic space. So namely, if you take the upper half space model, Rn minus 1 cross R plus, so this has a boundary at infinity, which is Rn minus 1 union a point at infinity. And it turns out that the isometry group of Hn can be described as the subgroup of the Moebius group generated by reflections in hyperplanes and inversions in spheres which are perpendicular to the boundary. So here you have the boundary. This is the upper half space. And you take only those hyperplanes which intersect the boundary at right angles. And those spheres which intersect the boundary at right angles. So this subgroup of the Moebius group turns out to be the isometry group of Hn. And now if you take any, say, reflection in a hyperplane, it sends the boundary to itself. If you restrict to the boundary, it becomes a reflection in a hyperplane of one dimension lower. And similarly, if you take an inversion in a sphere, if you restrict it to the boundary, it becomes an inversion in a sphere of one dimension lower. So that means if you take an isometry and restrict it to the boundary, then the boundary map is a Moebius map of the boundary. So it's an element of the Moebius group in one dimension lower. So you have this homomorphism from isometries of Hn to the Moebius group in one dimension lower. And this map, well, first of all, it's injective. In other words, isometry is determined by its boundary values. Because if the map on the boundary is identity, suppose F is identity on the boundary, then if you take any bi-infinite geodesic, the two endpoints on the boundary are fixed by F. So that means the geodesic has to be fixed by F. So now if you take a point X in Hn and you look at all the geodesics which pass through X, then each of those geodesics is fixed. So that means X has to be fixed. So F has to be identity. So this map is injective. And this map is surjective, because if you take a Moebius map of the boundary, say you take a reflection in a hyperplane in the boundary, then that extends to a reflection in a hyperplane of one dimension higher. And similarly, inversion in a sphere, you can extend the sphere to a sphere of one dimension higher, which intersects the boundary at right angles. And the inversion extends to inversion in the sphere of one dimension higher. So that means every Moebius map of the boundary extends to an isometry of the inside. So this map is an isomorphism. So in short, the isometries of HN are the same thing as the Moebius maps of its boundary. And this fact is used in many rigidity theorems for hyperbolic space, the most well-known probably being the Mostow rigidity theorem, which says that if you have closed hyperbolic N manifolds, where N is at least 3, then any isomorphism between their fundamental groups is in fact induced by an isometry between the manifolds. So let me quickly sketch the proof. So here you have the universal covers of your manifolds. So that's two copies of HN. So you choose a base point, X naught in each copy. And now you look at the orbit of X naught under the fundamental group of M and of N. So the fundamental group acts freely and transitively on the orbit. So it's identified with the orbit. And you have a map between fundamental groups. So that's going to give you a map between orbits. So you get a map between the orbits. And since your map between fundamental groups is a homomorphism, that means this map is equivariant with respect to the actions of the groups on the orbits. And now, since our quotient manifolds are compact, if I take a compact fundamental domain containing the base point, when I look at a translate of it near a point near the boundary, the Euclidean diameter of this fundamental domain has to go to 0 because the hyperbolic diameter is constant. So what that means is that the orbits accumulate on the entire sphere at infinity. And the map between orbits is a quasi-isometry, so that means roughly by Lipschitz at large distances. So therefore, this is a feature of negative curvature. A quasi-isometry will extend to the limit sets of the orbits at infinity, which is the whole sphere at infinity. And because the map between orbits is a quasi-isometry, the boundary map from sphere at infinity to sphere at infinity will be a quasi-conformal homeomorphism. So I don't want to give the technical definition of a quasi-conformal homeomorphism, but one way of saying it is that it distorts cross ratios by a bounded amount. So it's the same thing as a quasi-Mobius homeomorphism. And now the main step in the proof of Mostow rigidity is you have this map between the boundaries, which is quasi-conformal and equivariant with respect to the actions of the groups on the boundaries. And these two properties imply that it must be conformal. So an equivariant quasi-conformal map has to be conformal. And by a theorem of Liouville, any conformal map of the sphere is a Moebius map. So now we have a Moebius map between the boundaries. So we know any Moebius map extends to an isometry between the insides. So you get an equivariant isometry, which gives you descends to an isometry between the quotient manifolds. So when we look at constant negative curvature, then you see that the fundamental group determines the manifold up to isometry. So now we can ask what happens if you look at variable negative curvature. So suppose X is a closed, negatively curved manifold. Then negative curvature implies that each free homotopy class of closed curves contains a unique closed geodesic. So this means that you get a length function on the fundamental group of the manifold, where any based homotopy class gives you a free homotopy class. Take the length of the unique geodesic in that free homotopy class. So this gives you a length function on the fundamental group. And this is called the marked length spectrum of the manifold. That means the data of fundamental group together with the length function. And so now a natural question to ask is this length function enough to determine the manifold up to isometry? So this is the marked length spectrum rigidity problem that is given two closed negatively curved manifolds and an isomorphism between the fundamental groups which preserves lengths. Then does it follow that it's induced by an isometry between the manifolds? And so it's a theorem of Ottal that this is true in two dimensions. So variably curved surfaces are determined by their marked length spectrum. While in higher dimensions, the problem is still open, but this turns out to be equivalent to another problem. So a theorem of Hammingstad says that the marked length spectrum are equal if and only if the geodesic flows of the two manifolds are topologically conjugate. So that means there's a homeomorphism between the unit tangent bundles, which conjugates the geodesic flows. So an equivalent problem is, if you have two closed negatively curved manifolds whose geodesic flows are topologically conjugate, are the manifolds isometric? So now I want to look at this in a slightly more general context of negatively curved metric spaces called cat minus one spaces. So let me recall what a cat minus one space is. First of all, it's a length space. That means any two points can be joined by a geodesic in the metric space. So a geodesic in a metric space is simply an isometry from an interval in R to the metric space. Okay, it's just an isometric embedding of an interval into the metric space. And we require a synthetic notion of negative curvature. That means there is a synthetic notion that the curvature is bounded above by minus one, meaning that geodesic triangles in the cat minus one space should be in some sense thinner than in the model space H2 of constant curvature minus one. So what that means is, if you take three geodesics in X, which form a triangle, so this is inside X, then there exists a unique triangle in H2, which has the same side length as this triangle in X. So this is called a comparison triangle. So this is now a geodesic triangle in H2. And if you take two points on the sides of your triangle in X, say S and T, then since the sides are isometric, these correspond to two points in the comparison triangle, S bar and T bar. And what we require, the cat minus one inequality, is that the distance between S and T should be less than or equal to the distance between S bar and T bar. So the triangle in X is thinner than the triangle in H2, the comparison triangle. So some simple facts. First of all, there is a unique geodesic between any two points in a cat minus one space, because if you take two points, suppose you have two geodesics joining them, then you can always choose a point, say in the middle of one of these geodesics. So this gives you a geodesic triangle, but in this triangle, the sum of lengths of these two sides is equal to the length of the third side. So you have equality in the triangle inequality. So that means when you look at the comparison triangle, or a triangle in H2, if you have equality in the triangle inequality, it has to be a degenerate triangle. But if this triangle is degenerate, the triangle in X is thinner than the triangle in H2. So this also has to be degenerate. So therefore, these two geodesics are the same. So you can also show that the unique geodesic joining any two points, it depends continuously on the endpoints. So this gives you a way to contract the entire space to a base point. You choose one point in X, and then you contract points in X along geodesics from starting from the base point. So cat minus one spaces are contractible. And common examples, the example we'll be most interested in is if you take a complete simply connected manifold with sectional curvature less than or equal to minus one. So this is diffeomorphic to a ball. and it is a cat minus one space. And another common example is a metric tree. So for cat minus one spaces, we can define a boundary at infinity, which is given by equivalence classes of geodesic rays. So a geodesic ray is an isometry from the interval 0 infinity into x. And you identify two geodesic rays if the distance between them stays bounded. So geodesic rays which stay at bounded distance give you the same point at infinity. So some facts. First of all, given any point in the inside and a point in the boundary, there exists a unique geodesic joining the point inside to the point in the boundary. Secondly, given any two points in the boundary, there exists a unique geodesic joining those two points at infinity. And you can put a natural topology on the boundary on, yeah, go ahead. No. So, yeah. So, in fact, that's what this is saying, that given if you take one ray going to infinity and a base point, you can find another ray starting from that base point, which is asymptotic to this ray. So if you change the base point, from any base point, you can go to any point at infinity. Okay, so neighborhoods of, so to put a topology on X union its boundary, you have to describe neighborhoods of boundary points. So if you have a boundary point which is represented by a geodesic ray gamma, then neighborhoods are given by cones. So a cone is the following. Let me just draw the picture. So you take a large ball around your starting point of the geodesic, and you look at points outside this ball whose projection to this ball lies within distance epsilon of this point on the sphere intersect the geodesic. So this gives you a cone. This is a cone around xi, and this is a neighborhood of xi. So this is the cone topology. And it's a fact that X union its boundary is compact if and only if X is a proper metric space. So proper means that closed and bounded subsets of X are compact. It's a finite dimensionality kind of condition, properly. Okay, so two examples. So first of all, if you take a simply connected complete manifold with sectional curvature less than or equal to minus one, then if you choose a base point, then you get a map from the unit tangent sphere to the boundary. The natural map, given any unit tangent vector at x, you take the unique geodesic ray, which has v as its initial velocity. So that gives you a point at infinity. This map is a homeomorphism. So for such a manifold, the boundary is identified with a sphere. Another example, if you take X to be a tree, then the boundary is identified with the space of ends of the tree. So for example, if you take a rooted binary tree, then the boundary is identified with all ways you can go to infinity in the tree, that corresponds to infinite sequences of zeros and ones. So the boundary is identified as 0, 1 to the n with the product topology, which is a Cantor set. So now we want to define a metric on the boundary. So for this, first we can define given two points on the boundary, xi and eta, and given a point in the inside, x, you can define the angle between xi and eta as viewed from x as follows. So you take geodesic rays converging to x and to xi and eta starting from x. Now, if you take points PQ along these geodesic rays, that gives you a geodesic triangle. So you take the corresponding triangle in H2 and look at the angle at the vertex corresponding to x. So you get a sequence of angles, and now it's a fact that in a cat minus 1 space, these angles are monotonically increasing. As P and Q go across the ray, these angles increase monotonically. This, in fact, is equivalent to being a cat minus 1 space. The fact that comparison angles are monotone along geodesics, this is equivalent to being a cat minus 1 space. So therefore, the limit of these angles exists. And this is the comparison angle at infinity. So now, some properties of this angle. First of all, the angle is zero if and only if the two boundary points are the same. And the angle is pi if and only if the two boundary points are antipodal. So antipodal means that x lies on the geodesic joining xi and eta. So we can define now the visual metric. So this is going to depend on the choice of base point. It's defined to be sine half theta, where theta is the comparison angle. So if theta is between 0 and pi, sine half theta is between 0 and 1. Okay, so this is a diameter 1 metric, and this induces the cone topology on the boundary. And why do we take sine half theta? Well, just think of the example of HN. In HN, the comparison angle, theta, is the same as the Riemannian angle. And in the ball model, the Riemannian angle is the same as the Euclidean angle. So if you take the Euclidean angle, what is sine half theta? Well, this is half theta. Sine half theta is this side, right? So this is half the straight line distance between the two points. So in this, for HN, you get this visual metric is half the caudal metric on the sphere, the straight line metric on the sphere. But this metric, it's going to be useful to describe it in terms of another quantity, which is called the Gromov inner product. So the Gromov inner product, this is between, so the Gromov inner product between two points y and z as viewed, so x and y as viewed from a base point z is the following. You take the distance from the base point to x, distance from base point to y, subtract the distance from x to y, and take half of this. So why do we take half? Because if you take a tree, this Gromov inner product becomes a familiar quantity. So if you take a tree, then any two geodesics starting from a base point have to stay together for some time and then branch off. So in a tree, if you look at this Gromov inner product, you're going to take this distance plus this distance minus this distance. So these two sides cancel and you get twice this side. So when you take half, then you'll get exactly this distance. So in a tree, the Gromov inner product just tells you how long the two geodesics stay together. So it turns out that, first of all, so we define the Gromov inner product for two points in the inside with respect to a base point. Now you let those two points converge to two points at infinity, then the limit of the Gromov inner product exists. So this defines a Gromov inner product between two points at infinity, viewed from a base point. And it turns out that the visual metric is e to the minus Gromov inner product. So for example, this means if you take a tree where the boundary is 0, 1 to the n, then the visual metric is just going to be, so the two points on the boundary are two sequences of zeros and ones. You look at how long those two sequences are equal, and you take e to the minus n. So that's the usual ultrametric. It's a p-adic type metric. So that's what happens for a tree. So now let me talk about Moebius and conformal maps between metric spaces. So if you have a metric space, you can define the cross ratio of four points by the same formula, just using the metric on the space. And an embedding of metric spaces, you'll say it's Moebius if it preserves cross ratios. And now I want to, what is a conformal map? So you'll say a map is conformal if I take a point xi and let eta tend to xi, then this ratio distance between f xi, f eta the limit of this ratio exists. So what this means is, if this limit, if you call it lambda, what it means is if you take a small sphere in the domain of radius epsilon, then under f, this is going to map to something close to a sphere of radius lambda times epsilon. So this, so we call this the derivative of the conformal map. It's just a continuous, it's a positive function. So this gives you the infinitesimal scaling factor of the conformal map. And now it's a fact that any Moebius map is conformal. So how do you see that? Well, suppose I take eta close to xi. So what we can do is choose two other points, xi prime and eta prime. So I know that if I look at the cross ratio of these four points, then that is equal to the cross ratio of the four image points. But now, that means this ratio is constant equal to one. But now, if I let eta tend to xi, so these two distances on top go to zero, but all the other distances converge to positive numbers. So that means the ratio of these two distances, the limit has to exist. And you get an explicit formula for the derivative in terms of ratios of distances. Just think of this picture where these two collapse to points. That ratio has to exist. So you can say something stronger actually for Moebius maps. There is a geometric mean value theorem, which says the following. It says that the distance between the image points squared, so f xi f eta, is going to be equal to the distance between the points in the domain squared times the derivative at xi and derivative at eta. So how do you see this? Well, this is also easy to see. What you do is you take again your four points, but now you let the other two points below also collapse to each other. So you look at quadrilaterals where the two sides on top and bottom are collapsing. So when you pass to the limit in this picture, you'll get, you know, this divided by this gives you one derivative, this divided by this gives you another derivative, and then you have product of distances squared. So you get the geometric mean value theorem. So now I want to come back to the boundary. So here's an important fact. It says that if you take a visual metric, so based at some point x, now these visual metrics, it depends on the choice of the base point. But it turns out that the cross ratio defined by any visual metric is independent of the choice of base point. So how do we see this? Well, we know the visual metric is given by e to the minus Gromov inner product. So I have to take 4 points at infinity, so xi, eta, xi prime, eta prime, and I have to take e to the minus Gromov inner product. So that's going to be e to the half. So on top, I'll have minus this Gromov inner product. I take 4 points converging to these 4 points at infinity. So I get 4 triangles. So I have to take minus the Gromov inner product. So that means this comes with a plus, this sign, and I get a minus and a minus here. So I have this visual distance times this visual distance. So I'll have a plus here and a minus and a minus. But now these two distances, they are in the denominator. So they come with opposite signs. So here I'll have a minus and here a plus and a plus. Here a minus, here a plus and a plus. So all the distances in the middle cancel out. Plus minus, plus minus, plus minus, plus minus. So that means what you're left with doesn't depend on the base point. So the cross ratio becomes an alternating sum of distances, plus, minus, plus, minus. So this is the cross ratio. Okay. So some consequences of this fact. So the cross ratio, that it doesn't depend on the base point. What that means is, if I take two base points, x and y, then if I look at the identity map of the boundary, where I take boundary with the metric rho x and boundary with the metric rho y, then since the two have the same cross ratios, this map is Moebius. So since it's a Moebius map, it is conformal. So it has a derivative. So what is the derivative? So I'm going to write that derivative as d rho y by d rho x. So this is going to be a function on the boundary. It turns out this is just given by exponential of the Busemann function. So what is the Busemann function? So it's a function of two points in the inside, x, y, and a point xi at infinity on the boundary, which, roughly speaking, it measures the relative distance of x and y from the point xi at infinity. So the definition is you take a point, so here's xi, you take a point A converging to xi, you look at distance from x to A minus distance from y to A. So the relative distance, so this limit exists. And what? How do you see this? Well, if you take spheres with center at A and passing through the points x and the points y, then these spheres, as A tends to xi, these spheres converge to horospheres. And so the Busemann function is just the distance between these two horospheres. So it's the distance between horospheres passing through x and y. And so what does this formula mean? It means if I look at a small object based at xi, so here's a small object based at xi, then viewed from y is going to be larger than viewed from x by a factor of e to the b. So if y moves along this geodesic by a distance t, then this object is going to look larger by a factor e to the t. Okay? So scaling along geodesics towards xi, objects scale, they become larger by a factor e to the t, if you move a distance t towards xi. Okay, and now the cross ratio, because it's given by, in terms of distances in the inside, it's clear that if you have an isometry between cat minus 1 spaces, it's going to extend to a Moebius map between the boundaries. It's going to preserve cross ratios, because cross ratios are defined in terms of distances in the inside, which are preserved. So any isometry of cat minus 1 spaces extends to a Moebius map of their boundaries. Okay, good. So now, let's come back to Mach length spectrum. And so, what is the relation with Mach length spectrum? It is given by this theorem of Ottal, which says that if you have two closed negatively curved N manifolds, then they have the same Mach length spectrum if and only if the boundary map between the boundaries of the universal covers is Moebius. So let me explain this statement. What this means is the following. It's like the proof of Mostow rigidity. Suppose you have an isomorphism between fundamental groups, pi 1x to pi 1y. Then you look at the orbits of two points in the universal covers of x and y. You have a map between the orbits. That map is a quasi-isometry. It extends to a quasi-Mobius map between the boundaries at infinity. So what Ottal's result is saying, so these are steps 1 and 2 of Mostow rigidity. What Ottal's result is saying is that step 3 of Mostow rigidity, the main step in Mostow rigidity, which is to show that the boundary map is Mobius, this goes through if you assume that the map between fundamental groups preserves lengths. So lengths are preserved if and only if the boundary map is Mobius. So steps 1, 2, and 3 of Mostow rigidity go through verbatim. But what is the problem now? Problem is the last step. So, namely the question for cat minus 1 spaces, does a Mobius map between the boundaries extend to an isometry between the insides? And this is not obvious at all. This is equivalent to the Mach length spectrum problem for spaces with a co-compact action. So, let me give some results now. So, first of all, there's a theorem of Boudot, which says that if the domain of your Mobius map, X is a rank 1 symmetric space of negative curvature, so that means one of the hyperbolic spaces, either real hyperbolic, complex hyperbolic, quaternion, octonion, Kelly, hyperbolic, one of the hyperbolic spaces. And suppose you normalize the metric, so it's the metric is quarter pinched, sectional curvatures, so you normalize so that the maximum of the sectional curvatures is minus 1. The minimum will be minus 4. It's in between minus 1 and minus 4. Then y, if you take to be a cat minus 1 space, any cat minus 1 space, then any Mobius embedding between boundaries extends to an isometric embedding from x to y. So this is, we have an affirmative answer when the domain is a rank 1 symmetric space. Okay, now I want to talk about a related topic, which is the relation between conformal maps and geodesic conjugacies. So suppose X, Y are complete simply connected manifolds with sectional curvature less than or equal to minus 1. So they're just negatively curved balls. Then any conformal map between their boundaries actually induces a topological conjugacy of geodesic flows between the unit tangent bundles. So how do you get this conjugacy? Let me explain. So you start with a unit tangent vector V. I have to define its image as a unit tangent vector in Y. This is X and this is Y. So V defines a bi-infinite geodesic with endpoints, let's say, xi and eta. And you have a conformal map between the boundaries, F, from boundary X to boundary Y. So I can take the images of xi and eta. I look at F xi and F eta. And we look at the geodesic joining F xi to F eta. Now, we want to define the image of V, this unit tangent vector, to be some unit tangent vector which is tangent to this geodesic, say W. Okay? The point is, we have to choose where along the geodesic will W be. Is it high, low, where will it be? Right? We have to choose a base point, X, a Y, say. So say this point is X and this point is Y. Well, we know our boundary map is conformal, so we can look at the derivative df with respect to rho x and rho y at the point xi. Okay, at this point, look at the derivative. So the infinitesimal scaling factor. Now, what happens, so x is fixed. I have to choose y. So what happens if I move y close up along the geodesic? Well, I know the visual metric in the range, it scales by a factor e to the t. So that means the derivative, if I move y up, this derivative is going to become large. And if I move y down, then the derivative is going to become small. So therefore, there exists a unique y where the derivative becomes 1. So you choose that y. So you choose the unique y so that the derivative of the conformal map with respect to those two metrics becomes 1. Now, why does this preserve time along the geodesics? So if I flow v by time t, if I flow by time t here, then the metric on the domain, it scales by a factor e to the t. But that means to keep the derivative 1, I have to scale the metric in the range by the same factor e to the t. So that means you have to flow by time t here as well. So flowing by time t in the domain, the image flows by time t in the range. So this conjugates the geodesic flows. It preserves time along geodesics. Now, something special happens when the boundary map, so we took the boundary map, this works for any conformal map. This works for any conformal map. But suppose we take a Moebius map. So then something special happens. Then this geodesic conjugacy turns out to be flip equivariant. That means it respects the flip. So on the unit tangent bundle, you have the flip which sends a vector v to minus v. So if you look at, so flip equivariant means that v and minus v should go to w and minus w. Why is this true? This follows from the geometric mean value theorem. So look at the product of derivatives at xi and eta. By the geometric mean value theorem, this is a Moebius map, this is equal to distance in the range squared divided by distance in the domain. But these are antipodal points, so this distance is 1, this distance is 1, so that's 1 divided by 1, that's 1. So that means the product of the derivatives is 1, so that means that the derivative at xi, at the upper end point, this is 1 if and only if the derivative at the lower end point is 1. So the point which makes this top derivative 1 also makes the bottom derivative 1. So therefore, v and minus v will go to w and minus w. So this respects the flips. So now, we can measure, suppose we have a conformal map now, we can measure the failure of this conjugacy of geodesic flows to be flip equivariant. What do I mean by measure the failure? So I'm going to define a function called the integrated Schwarzian of f. The reason for the name Schwarzian will come up soon. So this is going to be a function on the space of geodesics of x. So the space of geodesics of x, it's parametrized by pairs of points on the boundary. So the normal notation for that is del2x. That means pairs of distinct points on the boundary. So we're going to define a function from del2x to r. What is that function? Well, you take a pair of points xi eta, that gives you a geodesic. Now take any vector tangent to that geodesic. So what's going to happen, in general, for a conformal map, v and minus v are going to go to w pointing upwards and some vector pointing downwards. So this is going to be phi of minus v, and this is phi of v. And the integrated Schwarzian is this distance, this sine distance. Okay, so this is Schwarzian of f at the point xi eta. Okay, so take this sine distance. So this is independent of the choice of vector v here. Okay, because if you move v up, then both these two vectors will flow up. So the difference, distance between them stays the same. So you can see, it's not hard to see that this you can also write in terms of derivatives as minus log of product of derivatives. So for a Moebius map, this is zero. The product of derivatives we saw was one. So this is zero for a Moebius map. And now, because it's given by a product of derivatives, you're taking log and derivatives satisfy the chain rule. This satisfies a co-cycle identity. So the integrated Schwarzian of F composed G is Schwarzian F composed G comma G plus Schwarzian of G. So why do I call it the integrated Schwarzian? Well, recall the classical Schwarzian derivative. So the classical Schwarzian derivative is a third order differential operator on conformal maps from open subsets of C to C, which vanishes if and only if a conformal map is Moebius. That's the classical Schwarzian derivative. And it also bounds on the Schwarzian derivative give you bounds on cross-ratio distortion. This is a well-known tool in geometric function theory. If you have bounds on the Schwarzian, that gives you bounds on cross-ratio distortion. So what happens here? Well, I need one definition. So let's say a conformal map is C1 conformal. If the derivative, so that's a positive function on the boundary, assume that's continuous. Okay? So this is a small, so for a Moebius map, this is satisfied. The derivative is a continuous function. So then we have the following result. So suppose we have X is simply connected complete manifold with sectional curvatures. So we need a lower curvature bound for this to work. So say between minus one and some minus B squared. And suppose Y is a proper geodesically complete cat minus one space. So geodesically complete means that any finite geodesic segment can be extended to a bi-infinite geodesic. Then if we have a conformal, a C1 conformal map between open subsets of del X and del Y, then we have an exact formula for the cross ratio of distortion. So if I look at cross ratio of image points divided by cross ratio in the domain, take log of that, we have an exact formula. It's in terms of alternating sums of the Schwarzian. So you have 4 points, and you take Schwarzian of this geodesic minus Schwarzian of this plus Schwarzian of this minus Schwarzian of this. We have an exact formula for the cross-ratio distortion, which is better than the classical case. Classical, you just have bounds on Schwarzian, give you bounds on cross-ratio distortion. Here you have exact formula. And what this means in particular, suppose the Schwarzian is zero, then the cross-ratio distortion is zero, which means F is Moebius. So therefore, a C1 conformal map is Moebius if and only if its Schwarzian vanishes. The same as in the classical case. So this is the reason for calling this function the Schwarzian. So now let me come to statement of results. So first, about the problem of extending Moebius maps to isometries. So we can do the following. So I'm just recalling the definition of a quasi-isometry between metric spaces. So there is a multiplicative constant k, so that distances are multiplied at most by k and 1 over k, and there is an additive constant epsilon. Okay, and you also want that the image of your map should be within bounded distance from any point of the range. So then the first result is the following. So suppose x, y are proper and geodesically complete cat minus 1 spaces, then any Moebius map from boundary x to boundary y extends to a 1 log 2 quasi-isometry from x to y, and the image is half log 2 dense in y. So the point is you have a multiplicative constant is 1, and the additive constant doesn't depend on the spaces. This works for all spaces. And if X and Y are trees, then actually you get an extension which is an isometry. Okay. So this is about almost a quasi-isometric extension of Moebius maps. But if we take the domain to be a complete simply connected manifold with curvature less than or equal to 1, then we can get some slightly stronger results. Namely, there's an infinitesimal rigidity result, which says the following. So suppose you have X is a complete simply connected XG0. So XG0. This is complete simply connected with sectional curvature less than or equal to minus 1. It says the following. Suppose I have, I fix a compact C inside X, and suppose I have a family of metrics GT, which are all negatively curved, sectional curvature less than minus 1, and suppose that I only allow to deform the metric on this compact set. So outside this compact, GT is equal to G0. Okay? The only deformation is on this compact. So what happens? Well, if these two are equal outside a compact, then the identity map from XG0 to XGT is a quasi-isometry. So it extends to a homeomorphism between the boundaries, boundary of X with respect to G0 to boundary of X with respect to GT. So let's call this identity hat T. So the theorem says, suppose these boundary maps are Moebius for all t, then each of them extends to an isometry. So this is an infinitesimal rigidity result. And we also have a local rigidity result, which is the similar setup. You fix a compact in your simply connected complete manifold. Then, given the compact, there exists an epsilon, which only depends on the compact, such that if you take another metric, which is, again, equal to G0 outside the compact, has sectional curvature less than minus 1, and you need to assume that the volumes of the compact with respect to G and G0 are the same, then, if the C3 norm of G minus G0 is less than epsilon, and if the boundary map from del x g0 to del x g is Moebius, then it extends to an isometry. So for small enough deformations on a compact, if the boundary map is Moebius, it extends to an isometry. So let me just, in the remaining 7 minutes, let me quickly sketch the proof of two of the theorems. So first of all, the almost isometric extension of Moebius maps. So that relies on the following construction. So suppose you take a compact diameter 1 metric space, which is antipodal. So antipodal means, so it's a diameter 1 metric space. Antipodal means given any xi, you can find an eta so that the distance between xi and eta is 1. So the diameter can be realized from any point of the space. Okay? So this is a small technical thing we need. So then you can define a space of Moebius metrics. That means you look at all the metrics rho on your metric space Z, which have the same cross ratio as rho 0, which have diameter 1, and which are antipodal. It turns out this turns into a metric space. And you can define a metric between, so the distance between two Moebius metrics rho 1 and rho 2, so if they have the same cross ratios, then the identity map is a Moebius, so it's conformal. So you look at the derivative of the identity map between rho 1 and rho 2. Take the maximum of log of the derivative. So this is something like, if you like, the Thurston metric on Trichmuller space. It's the best Lipschitz constant between rho 1 and rho 2. The only difference is, unlike the Thurston metric, this is symmetric. This is a symmetric metric. So it turns out that if X is a cat minus 1 space, then you have a natural map from X into the space of Moebius maps on the boundary, which sends a base point little x to visual metric based at X. This map turns out to be an isometric embedding. That's easy to see because if you take two points x and y, then we already saw this formula. The derivative d rho y by d rho x at xi, this is e to the Busemann function. So we have to take log of this. So this gives you the Busemann function, bxy xi. And then we have to take maximum of this over xi in the boundary x. So what is the maximum going to be? So here's x and y. So if I take a point here, then by triangle inequality, the Busemann function is going to be less than or equal to the distance between x and y. But it becomes equal to the distance when x, y, and xi are collinear. Right? When y lies on the geodesic joining x to xi, then the maximum, you attain the maximum. So the maximum is exactly dxy. So this is the distance between rho x and rho y. So this is an isometric embedding. And the main thing to prove is step two, that so the image of this isometric embedding inside the space of metrics is actually half log 2 dense inside the space of metrics. This is the main step. So almost every Moebius metric is a visual metric. Almost in the sense it's within distance half log 2 from some visual metric. So now the proof of the theorem is easy. If you have a Moebius map between boundaries, then by pushing forward metrics on the domain to metrics on the range, you get a map between the space of metrics on the domain, the space of metrics in the range, which is easy to see, it's an isometry. So now you just compose the maps. You have x going into the space of metrics on boundary x. You push forward by f to go to the space of metrics in boundary y. And now y is sitting inside the space of metrics in boundary y. You take a nearest point projection to y. Take the nearest point in y. So you compose these, this gives you your extension from x to y. So the first two maps are isometries, and the last map is a 1 log 2 quasi-isometry. So when you compose, you get a 1 log 2 quasi-isometry. So in the remaining 2 minutes, let me explain the infinitesimal rigidity. So first of all, suppose you have your metrics GT, which are, if they're equal to G0 outside a compact, then that means the boundary map is going to be locally Moebius. It won't be Moebius, but it will be locally Moebius. That's easy to see again, because if the metrics are equal outside a compact, if you take a point on the boundary, then it has a neighborhood. So that if I take any 4 points in this neighborhood, then all the geodesics joining them stay outside this compact. So if they are geodesics for G0, they are also geodesics for GT, which means the cross ratios are the same. So locally, cross ratios are the same. The difference is what happens when you have points which pass through the compact. So globally, it's not Moebius, but locally it is. But since it's locally Moebius, that means it's conformal. Okay, a locally Moebius map is also conformal. So since it's conformal, we can look at the integrated Schwarzian of the identity map from x boundary x g0 to boundary x gt. And it turns out the integrated Schwarzian, what this does, it measures the difference between lengths of bi-infinite geodesics. So in integrated Schwarzian of xi eta is going to be, you take points converging to the 2 points on the boundary, and you take the g0 distance minus the GT distance. This limit exists, and it equals the integrated Schwarzian. So now if you differentiate this identity with respect to t, you get a formula for the first variation of the integrated Schwarzian. It's given by what's called the ray transform. So if I differentiate at time 0, what I get is the ray transform of the symmetric tensor g0 dot. So g0 dot means ddt of gt at t equal to 0. That's a symmetric 2 tensor. So a symmetric 2 tensor I can think of as a function on the unit tension bundle. So I can integrate it along a bi-infinite geodesic. Now, I'll just take 1 minute to finish. So G0 dot is compactly supported. So the integral along a bi-infinite geodesic, it converges, okay? So this is the first variation of the integrated Schwarzian. So now we need to use a result of Sharafuddinov, which says that the kernel of the ray transform equals the infinitesimally trivial deformations of the metric. So that means if the ray transform of GT dot is zero, this happens if and only if GT dot is the Lie derivative of GT with respect to some vector field XT. So now we have a one parameter family of metrics so that all the boundary maps are Moebius. So if they're Moebius, then the Schwarzians are all zero. So DDT of the Schwarzian is zero. So that means the ray transform of GT dot is zero. So that means you get a vector field XT. So that GT dot is Lie derivative of GT with respect to XT. And now you're done, you just integrate this time dependent vector field to get a family of isometries. So I'll stop. It may be, I don't know. So for example, for a tree, I forgot to say this, every Moebius metric is visual. So that's how you extend from a tree to the inside. Every metric on the boundary is visual metric. I don't know if there are examples. It's unique, yeah. So this is, so actually it can be described using circumcenters. So what you do is you take, so that nearest point projection map, what you do is, I'll give you directly the map from X to Y. So I forgot to say this. So you take your point little x. Now what you do is you take a unit tangent sphere at X and you flow for time t. So you get the sphere of radius t. You take these tangent vectors. So these tangent vectors, you have a conjugacy between the unit tangent bundles. So you map across these tangent vectors. So that gives you some set of unit tangent vectors. Okay, take the base points of these unit tangent vectors. Now this is a bounded set, take its circumcenter. So you get a point which depends on t, but as t tends to infinity, these converge. And that is why. So it's a sort of infinite circumcenter. That's how you do it.